Your name is?
Willard Pfluger.
And you were born?
In 10-10-20.
So that makes you what we call over 90 years old.
94.
94 years old. And so you have you've had a wonderful life in Pflugerville, and you can remember, or you've seen a lot of changes. So.
I've seen lots of changes.
We're going to talk first about your family. Your grandfather, George, was the first to come over from Germany when he was 14 or 15 years of age.
He was 15 years old. Came over with his brother, and they settled with uncle and aunt. Aunt was a Pfluger east of Austin, and he lived with them till 1956. And he moved over to Pflugerville and started farming and ranching and whatever he did. And he might have bootlegged some, I don't know. But anyway, that's where it started. And then he bought land, and he was the instigator getting Pflugerville started. And I wasn't around to know what really happened, but I know that his wife died, and then he remarried, and he had I can't recall how many kids, but there was half brothers and half sisters involved in the deal. And he lived, he died in 1910, 10 years before I was born. So I really didn't know him. I knew my grandmother. She lived till I was, I think, 8 years old. I might be off a year, but I can remember taking milk down to my grandmother in a little 1 gallon tin pail. And I'd walk down, she lived about 4 blocks from us. And she'd come in, and I can't remember the German name. She said that poured in her pitcher. But the name didn't really sound real good to me. I always went down to see her, and I know she slipped, I think, on the ice, which caused her break her hip or something. I don't recall. I know when the church burned and they rebuilt the church, she donated the bell that's in the church. And if it wasn't closed up, I don't know how far you could hear that, because it's a huge, huge bell. And I remember that when the church was dedicated, I rang the bell, and my dad crawled up there a week, 10 days before the dedication, and wrapped inner tubes around the bell, and I'd go up and practice. And once I'd get the bell going, if I wouldn't turn loose of the rope, it would pull me off of the floor. And so if it wasn't, you know, boxed in, no telling how far you could hear that bell ring.
I think it was a custom too, in previous times, that they would ring the bell when someone passed away in the community.
Right, yeah.
And that was kind of the signal to everybody throughout the whole area that there had been a death in
that's
the
right.
Community.
It had And when someone would pass away, well, they would ring the bell, and that kind of gave the everybody that heard it knew that somebody had passed away, and I guess that's when the telephone started ringing to see who it was. But
so George obviously was a very intelligent man. He selected a homestead that was close to Gillian Creek, and I assume part of that was because it was a source of good water.
Yeah, it was a spring in the creek where he got his water, and when the trains came through, they ruined his spring down there, so the railroad came up on and started digging in solid rock, and that it's about 16 or 18 foot deep, and he cooled his watermelon and his beer and everything in that well, and people from town came and carried water from that well for their drinking water for, I guess, years and years. I wasn't there, but it, and the well is still there, and it's dug in solid rock. I mean, so.
At Gillian Creek is right on the edge of the Edwards Plateau or the Edwards Aquifer, and then we go into the Blackland Prairie, which was the good farmland.
Right.
Both, I assume your grandfather George and your dad were both cattlemen. They raised cattle?
Yes, sure
and
did.
What
yeah.
kind of cattle did they start with?
Well, Dad started with Herefords. Now, what Grandpa had, I don't know because I wasn't here. But I imagine he, more than likely Herefords, because they were kind of the breed of the times right at that time. So
if they had, where would they take the cattle to sell them, your dad or grandfather?
Well, they sold a few in Austin, but when I got big enough to see what was going on, they dad loaded them on the railroad and would ship them to Fort Worth, and they had a caboose on the train, and he would ride the caboose up there, so he'd be there when the cattle sold. And I went on one trip with him when I was, I'd say probably 12, 14, 15 years old. And it was quite an experience that I don't imagine many kids got an experience like that.
So that was the now famous Fort Worth Stockyards,
right,
where they
right.
took the cattle.
Yeah.
Did you ever hear stories about before the railroad, them taking the cattle on a cattle drive?
Well, I heard them talking about it, but I really don't know any history about it. They talked about taking them to Kansas, I believe. And so I don't know, couldn't tell you anything that really happened because I don't know.
We'll just stop for a minute. Okay, so with the cattle also, it was open range at first, and then they had to build fences. Did you ever build fence?
Quite a few, but yeah, it's more fences that, well, I guess down below Taylor at Noack, that fence is still up. I guess all the rest of them were tore down, but I got an education building fences. It's now we used to go up to Cedar Park and get Cedar Post. And at that time, all that was at Cedar Park was an old Texaco station with old visible pump and about four cedar yards, and that was the town of Cedar Park. And time or two we went up with wagon and mules and got them, and then finally got to the age of Dad finally got a pickup, and he got him a trailer and hauled them in a trailer.
Do you remember your first pickup or truck?
The first pickup I got was in 1946. I bought it at Manor, and I told Ed Acklin, I said, I don't want a dark-colored pickup. I said, I want a light-colored. And he said, he finally called me, and he said, got you a pickup, but we got a few problems. And I said, what's the problem? He said, well, I said, one thing, the pickup is black, and the next problem, it don't have a bed on it, but it got the fenders tied on the back. And I told him, he said, do you want it? And I said, Ed, I don't care if it got barber pole stripes on it. I said, we'll be there. And I picked Marvin Weiss up, and we went and got that pickup. And Claude King, was doing all my welding, had told me that he had built a pickup bed. And so I took it over to Claude. Next morning, we went to Austin, to the Austin Iron Works, got the steel, and he built that pickup bed. And it's behind the house now, yet. It built out of 3/8-inch steel, and it would outlast a dozen pickups yet. And I took it off when I bought a new pickup, because I wanted to put it on another pickup, and I never could find a 46 pickup to put it on. I wanted an old antique, but.
Most of the vehicles were dark colored in the early years, weren't they, all of them?
Yeah, they were dark colored.
To get a light colored was nearly a special order.
Yeah. But I sold a pickup to Grover Kimpel, and I went down and tried to buy it back, and he had already sold it. So I still got the bed.
I'm going to go back to, again, George Pfluger. I know you didn't know your grandfather, but I read in the Pfluger history book that he actually served some time in the Civil War.
I couldn't give you anything.
He was called a wagoneer. He was in charge of the wagons, I think.
Yeah, well, I tell you, he hauled freight to Houston and Galveston with oxen, I was told.
Okay.
And they said sometime he'd be gone for 6 weeks to make that trip. And just what I heard.
So did you ever hear a story of how the MKT, Missouri, Kansas, Texas Railroad, they wanted to build a railroad, and obviously they talked with George about coming through his property, and he donated land?
He donated all the land from, it's up where Fennec Lane is now to south of Pflugerville.
Okay.
And, of course, where the depot was and everything where the railroad was, he donated it, and that's one thing the railroad, when they wanted to close, I was the only shipper on it, and I made a deal with them to that they would sell me the land if I'd sign off that I wouldn't ship any more grain so they could close the railroad. And they closed the railroad, but then when I went to Dallas to close the deal, they said, oh, said it was a different attorney there, said, and they wouldn't honor the deal, so I didn't get the land. And
what was the reason the railroad closed? Was it, did they?
It wasn't paying them any.
There were other means of transportation?
Yeah, they could come in a different route. And so they just closed it up. Because I was nothing. Well, Otto Pfluger, he got coal shipped in. And of course, the gin went electric. And it wasn't no more coal shipped in. And then I was the only shipper that shipped grain out. And so I was actually shipping more by truck than I was by rail. And I received grain by rail when we first opened up. But trucks was always, it's easier to handle them than those cars were. You'd get a car loaded and man, you had to move it and get out there with pry bars and everything to try to get it moved down the track where you could move another one in. And so I just finally started, as the trucking business got larger, well, I just went to trucks. And
the railroad closed then in the 70s? That was after the city was
I guess, yeah, it was probably in the 70s when they closed.
And right by the railroad track also was the ice house years ago. As a young boy, did y'all have to get ice from there for your home?
From ice?
Ice. Uh-huh.
From the railroad?
From the ice house there, yeah. Across from Seaman's garage.
Oh, yeah. We got ice from them, you know, all the time. And in fact, I helped haul ice from Pflugerville to down to New Sweden and stuff. I got a little job with the ice factory, and we hauled that ice down there and back a pickup at those bars. They weighed 330 pounds, and but we learned how to handle them.
So did you wrap it in burlap, or what? How did you transport it? On a truck?
On a truck, and we covered it up with a tarp, and then we just slide them in the ice house when we got down to New Sweden.
Now, was that New Sweden store there close to 685 where mm-hmm. the cemetery is?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, then back to the railroad came through, and your dad and his dad, George, platted the town.
Right, yeah.
Did your dad ever say, did they just sit down and do it, or did they have somebody to come in and help them?
All I know that they platted the town. I don't know if they had help or if they just...
There was also a St. George Hotel that was built, and I guess that was named in honor of your grandfather.
Yeah, he built that, and that's all I know about it, that he had built it, and then it burned down. And some of the rock and cement, it was still back of...
Wordyisms there, the old post office?
Well, it was below the post, below, kind of on the ground at...
Bernie's? Huh? Was it as far down as Bernie's Texaco?
No. It was right there where, what's his name, has the tax...
Blakesley's?
Blakesley, yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And there's a well was right behind that. Okay. And I guess it's covered up now. I don't know why. I did, but there was concrete there for years and years that what came from the old hotel.
Yeah. Did he build other buildings in town there on Main Street?
That I couldn't tell you.
Okay.
I wasn't there.
Yeah, okay. All right. The home that you lived in, which is on Walnut Street between Walnut and Wilbarger, is one of the most beautiful homes in Pflugerville, and is still occupied. Nice porch. Tell us about living in that house, what you remember with the cross ventilation and the doors. And
well, it was a big old house, and it had a hallway through it that I imagine is many square feet as some of the little homes now. And there were three bedrooms downstairs and two upstairs and room for two more to be built, but they never did build them. And of course, when I was just a baby, I slept in the bedroom with mother and dad. And then as I got a little older, or big enough to go up the steps, George and I, we shared a bedroom up there. And on the west side, and the girls were over on the east side.
Do you remember Christmas? Did y'all have a Christmas tree with candles?
Oh gosh, we always had a Christmas tree, and you didn't know anything about, not there wasn't a Santa Claus, because Dad always had, Ewald Steger and I forget who, they always dressed up like a Santa Claus.
So and they had a real Santa Claus.
They made believers out of us when we were kids, because living room between the living room and the kitchen is two sliding doors. I mean, there are, I guess, 8 or 10 foot tall, and those doors stayed closed till everybody was in the dining room, and then they'd slide those doors open.
That was the tree.
That was Christmas, and they had all the presents there, and it was quite a show.
Do you remember any of your early presents when you were a boy, what you got for Christmas?
Oh, no, not offhand. I can't, because, you know, that back then was the Depression days, and we didn't get very large presents. We just had more or less things that you could wear, that rather than toys. And that I'm sure I got some toys, but I can't remember them. I never did get a bicycle until I was quite a bit older, knew that Santa Claus didn't bring it. But
Can you remember the first tractor your dad may have gotten?
Oh yeah, it was an old regular farm hall. And it was back in the early 30s.
Iron wheels,
and you had to put lugs on them when you plowed in the field, because you couldn't go on the highway with them. And when he bought that thresher in 1934-35, well, we'd have to take those lugs off and to get on the highway. Then we'd get off in the field, and we'd have to put the lugs on to pull the thresher.
But he had a thrasher, and he would go around and thrash for other farmers
yeah.
to help them
well,
harvest.
What caused him to get the thrasher? There was four or five thrashers around the country, and they wanted a nickel a bushel to thrash it, and then you had to feed the thrasher hands at noon and give them lunch in the afternoon. And oats wasn't worth but 15 cents a pound, bushel. And so that didn't leave the farmer very much. And Dad had quite a bit of oats back in those days. So he went to Dallas and bought a thrasher and dropped the thrashing to 3 cents a bushel. He thrashed 90-some thousand bushels that year. He thrashed enough oats at 3 cents to pay for the thrasher. Of course, he did. It didn't pay any of the expenses. He had Fred Schaefer that helped him thrash. And so the gasoline and oil and things like that and labor that he paid was out of his pocket, but he
did
paid for the thrasher, and people waited around for him to come thrash there because 2 cents was 2 cents back then. And later year, George helped him. And then when George quit, I started helping him, and I helped run the thrasher for 16, 17 years. And then
how did he get the thrasher back from Dallas? Did he have it on a truck or come on a
railroad? International.
Delivered it?
I guess they probably delivered it on a train.
So do you remember the blacksmith shops downtown?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the old Mexican blacksmith. Well, let's see, what was his name? Riagas, I believe. And then, I'm trying to think of, it was a white fellow, King, Doc King. He had a blacksmith right below where Sigmund's store was. And then he sold it to old colored fellow, Ross was his last name. I can't remember what his first name was. But old Ross ran it then for years. King moved it to Hutto. And then eventually Ross closed it up and moved it over to Dessau, and that's where he died, over there.
So what would you go to the blacksmith shop for your sweeps or?
Sharpening sweeps, and that was primarily the mm-hmm. thing, and they shod mules and horses and things like that. Anytime you needed a piece of iron bent, well, they'd put it in their forge and heat it up and bend it the way you wanted it.
And I guess in the early days they worked on wagons, and then they were replaced eventually by the cars and the trucks.
They worked on lots of wagons and plows and stuff like that. The old wagon wheels, they would the rims come off, and they'd have to put new spokes in the wheel, and
once people started buying cars, then there was a need for gas stations in town. And
yeah.
About how many gas stations were there at one time? 4 or 5?
Well, let's see. There was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them.
So You eventually became a businessman too, and had the Humble distributorship.
Yeah. Started that in 49.
In 49.
Mm-hmm.
And you had an elevated one tank or two tanks, big storage tanks? Where you stored the gasoline?
Gasoline had four.
Four?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And then you serviced most of Central Texas in
Central
general?
Texas, and I even went up to the lakes. I had 11
stations?
Where they sold bait and stuff and rented boats and that. And it was a pretty long trip up there. And by going up there, like when they did Laga Vista and another subdivision, I sold gas to those people, and I didn't depend on just trade around locally, and that was my idea, to go out and get business and bring money into Pflugerville instead of it going out all the time. And so that's the reason I built an elevator. Everything was going to Hutto and Georgetown, Elgin, Taylor, and I built that. And I had a partner for a few years, and we parted ways. The deal was that I'd manage it and he'd do the bookwork. And then I was managed it and doing the bookwork too. So I told him one day that I wanted to sell. And he said, well, he didn't. And I said, well, that's good. You buy me out. And he said, okay. And he said, how much? And I said, well, I'll tell you what. I think the only fair way is put down on a piece of paper what you'll take or what you'll give. And so I put down two figures, and he put down two, and he looked at him and he said, well, you put the same figure down. I said, that's right. I said, I'll buy or I'll sell at that figure. Well, if he bought me, he didn't want to give me near as much as I offered him. But if he kept it, in other words, there was quite a difference in his bids. And so I told him, I said, well, just pay me off. And so I think what he did is went to the bank in Austin that we were dealing with, and I don't think they would carry the note. So he finally came back and said, I believe I just sell out to you. And
I'm going to clarify for the record, the elevator meant Mr. Pfluger had a granary and the grain sorghum, or did you also take corn?
No, we
just
quit.
Grain, maize.
I quit just in time that corn started, because I couldn't store corn in the Malo, because I had I had 11,000 square foot building that would hold about 130-140 cars of grain. And I couldn't have mixed it.
And this was a very important business to have in an agricultural community. It was convenient for the farmers to harvest right to Pflugerville rather than going to the surrounding towns.
And your dad was one of them that thanked me several times for building it. He said, man, this makes it so much convenient for us. And I remember him one day. I had a fellow that traded with me with a gasoline and diesel ever since I started until then, and his dad did. And And but he was always a little behind on his payment. And he'd come in and say, well, said, I'm gonna get some money in, I'll pay you in 2 weeks or something like that. And I remember one time I had just come back from Austin and borrowed some more money to pay for grain. And this fellow was in there, came in, and your dad was there, and I paid him, and I remember his check was $12,000 and your dad always had his billfold, always put his billfold up in his overall. And finally, I asked another fellow, I sent him for you. He said, yeah. Said, I'd like to sell a little of my grain. I said, you know, I just came from Austin and I borrowed a little money, and they said it'd probably be 2-3 weeks before they could loan me any more. He turned red in the face, and your dad reached up for it, and he said, here, Willard, I don't need it. I said, take it. And I said, no, Gene. I said, I was just kidding him. But
one of the things you also did as a businessman is you supported the young
second.
People.
Hold on.
Okay.
With all that going on.
Okay.
Plus, let me scoot up.
Are we going to be close to switching tapes? Do you have another tape?
You got 45 minutes left.
Okay.
I'm just scooting up because he's getting a little bit too much sunlight.
Do we need to go over anything?
No, I just was stopping because he had a bunch of sunlight on his arm, and that was just getting loud and loud and loud.
Okay.
So.
Tell me when.
First and second grade, and I was always proud of my handwriting. Not bragging or boasting, I did have a good handwriting, but don't ask me to write now. I wrote a fellow a check the other day, and the bank wouldn't cash it.
You know that today the children in school do not learn how to write.
Well, I'm sure of that. That's what bothers me, the way they're teaching now. I got grandkids and great-grandkids, and they know how to take that phone and do everything on it. But if they had to count to 1, 2, 3, I don't know if they could do it or not.
What were the school hours? What time did you go to school and what time did you get out?
8 to 4.
And how many months a year did you go to school?
9.
9 months, okay. And did you go through the 11th or 12th grade?
We just had 11.
11 grades?
Yeah.
Okay, now you were an athlete in high school?
Yeah.
And tell us what kind of activities, what kind of sports you had.
I lettered in football, basketball, baseball, track, and a whole 9 yards. I busted a little math course my last year just so I could come back and play football another year, and I actually graduated it at midterm. And I remember when we went to Leander to play, they held the game up about 3/4 of an hour to check my birth certificate. And I was younger than some of their boys were, but I'd been playing for so long that they thought I'd an old grandpa. And
what position did you play in football?
Mostly quarterback.
What kind of offense did you run?
Oh, back in those days, we didn't have the coaching. We ran the wing formation most of the time. And that's about the only formation the coaches knew back then. We didn't have the training and things like that.
Did you have shoulder pads?
Oh, yeah. And we had helmets. I mean, they were little old thin things with little leather on the outside and some cotton inside, the pressed cotton. They wasn't very good helmets.
Where did you play your football games, and what time of the day?
Well, we played in the afternoon, and we played in Uncle Fritz's pasture, right? Well, let's see. You'd go between the school and the gym and go over the fence into his pasture, and that's where we played.
So it was in the afternoon.
Yeah.
Did you use the dressing rooms then in the rock gym?
No, the rock gym wasn't. We used them up at school. Well, I don't know.
Okay.
Might have been the coal shed. I don't know.
Right beside the rock gym up on C.C. Kemple's place, that I think C.C. Kemple was your uncle, they had the CCC camp, or the WPA program. Tell us a little bit what you remember about that. They had barracks in there?
Oh, they had lots of barracks and a lot of guys, and they went out and they built deals to control the water.
Structures?
And they wasn't very successful. I think there's a few around the country yet, but they didn't do what they thought they would do. It was kind of a...
When they were building the rock gym, did they finish it, or it was incomplete and then the local people had to finish it?
It's some of the local people, Lawrence Pfluger and that age group, Pete Pfluger and Otto Pfluger and I guess Rip Kimple, some of those, they completed it. They ran out of money.
You said you played Leander. What other schools did y'all play?
Oh, we played Maynard, Hutto. Leander, what's about right about
Liberty Hill?
Liberty Hill. And
y'all went by bus then, or how did you go to those places? Did they have a school bus?
No. We had to find your own way. I remember one time we were going to Leander.
Liberty Hill.
And I was taking Dad's car, and I believe it's Bruno Shane and Emmett Wyszewski. They were going to ride with me, and we was going to take our girlfriends with us, and the superintendent said we couldn't do it. And I said, okay. Can't do it. I said, we just won't play. And we went on up there, and Liberty Hill was running over them. And I remember my brother George was up there, and Fowler and all that group. And George came to me and he said, Willard, y'all got to get in there and play. He said, we bet some money on this game. And said, we're not going to win it the way it's going. So we went back in the bushes and they carried our uniforms up there for us. And we put our uniforms on at half. And we started playing and we beat them. And I never will forget, I guess that was the hardest I ever hit her. Boy, I was playing safety and he was coming around our left end. And I just passed the defensive back and the end of that. And he was right on the sideline and I hit him and man, we went over in the Liberty Hill band. We scattered chairs and instruments. But I was mad. I was
Always in schools, they have to have ways to raise money. And on the old football field, they had what was called a womanless wedding. Do you remember participating in that?
I remember having one, but I don't remember a thing in the world about it. Okay. I really don't.
What about when you were in school? Did y'all ever have to try to sell things? Of course, that was through the war. Maybe they didn't have that.
Yeah, well, I know they, the girls had box lunches, and you'd go up there, and they would get up there and put
auction them off.
And I remember my dad, he was quite a character about that. And he bought, I guess, 4 or 5 of those boxes. Man, he had little girls sitting all around him. He had more food than he could eat in a week. But he just enjoyed doing it.
You mentioned your dad had Hereford cattle, and then you also went into the cattle business and eventually ended up with a very noted brand called the Limousine.
No, he didn't go in that.
No, I did.
In
the Limousine.
Yeah. No, that was after Dad died. I mean,
okay.
he finally just went and bought cows. I mean,
okay.
If a cow showed that she'd give good milk and raise a calf, that's what he'd buy.
You didn't have to have the purebred.
No, the cows could have the rainbow colors and he'd buy it. It didn't make him any different. Just long as it raised a good calf.
You became known around the state with your limousines and were in the Texas Limousine Association, and you were president for 3 years?
3 years.
Tell us about your experience in the limousine business.
Well, it was a new organization, and we didn't have a lot of members, and they were having money getting it together, and finally they decided, the president ahead of me, they decided that they would sell a lifetime membership like the National does. And I told them, I said, it's not gonna work. It won't work. And they said, oh yeah, we'll get this money in. Well, they got it in, and they spent it all up there. Well, with National, you register your cattle through the National, and they charge you for that. So they got an income, and they make money out of it. And so we had a hard time, and we finally got it where we got donations and had different things and raised some money. I know when I was elected president, I had to put money in the bank to cover their checks.
I remember one story after you had moved into this home that you had a cow that ended up in your swimming pool.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that story.
Before we got a fence around the backyard, well, we had a big swimming pool in the back, and it's covered up now. I looked out there one day, and his cow just swimming back and forth. And I went down to the shop to get some help, and I was debating how we were gonna get her out. When we got up there and just fixed to get her out, she had found the steps, and she walked out, And then it made me mad because she didn't stand there long enough I could get a picture of her.
Okay, in 1965, 50 years ago, was when Pflugerville became incorporated.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a big thing for the people that were living in town. They had $0 to operate their city on. Anything you remember about people talking about those first years?
Well, I remember when they're talking about their streets and that, because the county had been keeping up the streets. And I remember N.L. Galt, the commissioner, told me, he said, Willard, I wanted to come in there and bring your streets up, you know, to the best I could. But he said, you know, I got to thinking about it. Said, all those people, women and all, they had their ditches where they could mow through them. And he said, you know, I had to tear all those ditches up to build the streets. And he said, you know, I figured I'd catch more hell over it than fixing the streets. So I didn't fix the streets. But I remember that, and then, of course, like I say, I just didn't get into politics, and I don't know what the council decided and all this and that. I never went to a council meeting in my life. I just, no, I take it back. I went to one. When I was subdividing that place in town, we wanted to put a street out to railroad. And then some lady got up and she said, oh, you'll put too much traffic on my road. And she said, I said, well, I come out of there from the grain elevator every day. And I said, I don't look up or down if a train is coming. I look at my watch to see what time it is, because the only two people that traveled that road regular was Ben O'Wilkie and the one had the dairy. His son died. Well, both his sons died. Mary was married to his son. But anyway, I said, those are the only two people that use it. And I said, one of them uses it in the morning to go out to his dairy, and the other one uses it about 10 o'clock to come to town to drink beer. And I said, and about 12:30, one goes back home for lunch. He takes meat back for lunch, and the other one comes home for lunch. And I said, other than that, we just don't have no traffic. And I said, I don't want to be ugly to you, but I said, if you're not satisfied the way they run it now, I said, I suggest you'd go back to where you came from. She sat down, and I never heard another word out of her.
Was that the Litkeys, maybe, you were talking? The Litke dairy?
Litkeys, John.
Now, was that the Wood Creek little area there where you used to have the Humble Distributorship? That was built in what year?
The
shopping center there. I know you didn't build it, but...
That was mine.
It was yours?
The land was mine.
Okay.
And I sold it to for the post office, and then I sold the rest to them.
Right.
Well, in fact, I sold it to Cheryl and her husband.
Right. And what year was that? In the 70s?
I'm sure it was, yeah. Because I begged them. I said, y'all are too early to build this. And they found out they were, and a year or two later it took off. But I just had a feeling that what they were building wasn't going to work. But
what were some of the things you remember about the business people in town? Mr. Nasey or Mr.
Oh, Mr. Nasey. I used to go in him, and he made the best mint juleps. And Mr. Emkin and I'd go in there and get ice cream and just different things and get the mail, because he was a postmaster there for a long time. And I know that you'd go get a prescription filled, and they'd have to make it. I mean, it didn't come to them in bottles. It just, the product came and they'd have to mix some things, and they'd back there and they'd grind that stuff up and finally put it in a pill. And
there were some doctor's offices at the top. Yeah. Do you remember any of the doctors that served in the community?
Dr. Kessler and oh, what was that? I thought of his name the other day. He was from down around little in East Texas. And
where did Dr. Kuhn practice? Out of his house, or was he downtown?
Out of his house.
That was before you were born, Dr. Kuhn?
No. I guess he delivered me. He lived right across the street from us. And he would go out with horse and buggy, and sometimes just ride a horse, go out to a patient, down as far as Richland and down in there. And his old horse played out on him, and he asked Dad if he could use his horse, and Dad said, "No, you can't use my horse, because Dad had a good cow horse." And he said, "But that little roan horse, you can ride him." "Oh," he said, "that little horse, he can't make it." And Dad said, "I believe he can." And so he took him and went out that night. Next morning, the horse wasn't back in the stable, and Dad walked over. His barn was right across the road from Dad, and he went over, and Dr. Kuhn, he was petting that horse, a pretty little horse, petting him and curing him, and he rode that horse for I don't know how long. That was a tough little horse he had raised up there on that ranch in Round Rock, and couldn't keep shoes on him. His feet were just tough. And I finally got him, and I rode him for years, and finally I had to kill him. I mean, he just got so old that couldn't go anymore.
Now, y'all's house was right in town, but you had, and behind there, you had barns and everything, regular farm, even though you lived in town.
Yeah,
you were right on the
edge. Yeah. See, that he had barns there, and the land went down to the bridge, railroad bridge, and the other bridge, and it'd go under, and then had land on the other side.
Now, where was that bridge? Is that close to where the Lions Hall is now, or where was the bridge you're talking about?
Yeah, where the bridge is now.
That's where the other one was.
Yeah.
It was kind of a one-lane bridge, bridge?
Yeah, well, it was just the old wood bridge. And
whatever happened to that bridge?
Oh, they tore it down and built this other one.
Okay.
Yeah, you'd go over it and it'd just take clack, 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 the little boards.
Do you remember much of the impact of World War II on the community around here? What was it like? What was the feeling? What was the...
Well, I don't know. Lots of us went, and some of them went early, and some of us went late, and it was a lot of talk about who went and who didn't go, and I know a lot of them my same age, they didn't go. They were single. I was married, had a little girl, so finally these went, and I came home. I told my wife, I said, well, I said, goodbye. I said, I'll be getting a notice in a few days. And sure enough, I did. I never went overseas.
Where were you stationed?
I took my basic at Fort Hood, and then they sent me up at Camp Massey. At Paris, Texas, and then they shipped me out to California, and they put me in a deal out there, and I cooked in the Army. And one day we'd cook for 20 people, and the next day we'd cook for 300-400. It was quite an experience, and I got in pretty good with the field sergeant. The first time we ever went out on a gun range, and we had walked about 8 or 10 miles out there, and they brought lunch out, and he said, I need 3 volunteers. And I said, I'll go. He looked at me and he said, Flugger, you won't go. I said, yeah, I'll go. And so he had to pick 2 more. And I said, well, now what should we do? He said, catch the chow trucks, go in and wash all these dishes. We went in and we washed those dishes, and PX was up, open, and we went up there and drinking beer when the other ones came in. And from then on, every time we was out on a deal, he never asked me, asked for 3 volunteer. He said, Flugger, just fall in. And man, I'd rather wash those dishes than walk 8 or 10 miles.
The first mayor of Pflugerville was I.B. Krenke. That was your brother-in-law.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just, for the people today, they want to know a little bit about I.B. Tell us a little bit about I.B. We went by I.B. I don't even know what his real name was. People called people by initials.
That's right.
So
Krenke, he was working at the bank, and he decided to, well, Mutt Fennick, Ella's husband, was selling insurance, and he was doing real well, lived in San Antonio, and I guess I.B. had talked to him, and Mutt had 3 or 4 agents working under him, and so I.B. said, well, I believe I'll just try it up here, and he kind of worked at Taylor area and south east of that and up towards Temple, and was very successful. And a lot of people, when he said he's going to quit the bank, they said, you mean you quitting the bank job to sell insurance? And he said, yeah. And of course, he didn't tell them, but he wasn't making but $50 a month at that time.
I know he was a Sunday school superintendent for many years.
Yeah.
And I think he served as mayor for 10 years.
Yeah, I don't know how long he was mayor.
And he did not have any children.
No. No,
And W.E. Pfluger was another early person that served. It was W.E. Pfluger and Burwell, or Tuff Knable, that served with IB. So tell us a little bit about W.E., the banker.
Well, I guess he worked in the bank all his life. That's the only thing he ever did. Mm-hmm. And
do you remember when they had that bank robbery in Pflugerville?
Yeah.
You want to tell us about that?
We were sitting in the cafe eating, and it was two cops in there eating, and they got a call that it's having a bank robbery, and they jumped up, and of course they just left their food, and of course I stayed there. I didn't go around there because I didn't have no gun or nothing, and that's about all I know about it. We wasn't there. We were in the restaurant, but I can't remember. Did they catch those fellows? I don't think they did.
Okay, and the other one was Tuff Knable. Tell us what he did.
Do what?
Tuff Knable was also on the first city council for
about
10 years.
Yeah.
Tell us what his business was.
well, Tuff, I don't know what he did at one time. He had some cleaning outfit. He went around and demonstrated cleaning products, and he would clean bathrooms and commodes and stuff like that. And he finally quit that and came in and started in the beer business with his folks. And of course, when his daddy died, well, he stayed there, and then he and his mother ran it, and after she died, well, he just kept it, and that's all he did. And
you were a volunteer in a lot of areas. You already talked about being president of the Limousine Association, and that was a volunteer post. You didn't get paid to do that. The Pflugerville Fire Department was formed in 1955 with volunteers. Were you part of that?
Waldemar and Otto Pfluger and Roy Kimple and I, we met at the bank one night and decided that Pflugerville needed a fire department. And so we kind of spread the word around and then finally called a community committee to go out and try to get some money together. And right before the meeting, Otto, he came up to me and he said, what are we going to talk about tonight? And I said, well, I don't know. I said, I'll tell the information I got. And he said, what's that? And I said, well, I got a Chevrolet dealer down at Manor to sell us a truck below cost. It wasn't much, like $100 or something. But I went to San Antonio to, I forget what the name of the fire department, sold equipment. I had them to figure out what they would, fix that truck up. And they figured a 250-gallon water tank and pumps and different stuff. And at I believe the price was around $4,000, or maybe one or two or something in that neighborhood. And he said, well, you better take care of the meeting. I said, no, I'm not going to take care of it. I said, you take care of it, and you can just tell them what I did, and they can decide. And so he presented it to them, and so they agreed to get, I think it was about four or five couples and older people, like Dad and Uncle Fritz and Henry Kimple and older men, to go out and solicit and see if they couldn't get some money raised. And they went out and they raised enough money to pay for that truck. And I remember they went to Herman Meister, and Herman Meister said, I wouldn't give them nothing. And so he, and the funny thing, his house burned, was the first one to catch fire that burned down. Now, the first fire we had was the day they brought the fire truck in, and they had it over where the fire department is now, just on vacant ground. And they showed us how to run it and everything. And my gasoline dealership was right across the street. And it's about 2:30, 3 o'clock that afternoon. I was over loading my truck, and I saw J.B. Marshall walking down from his place, and he got in that truck, and he just hit that siren a little bit. It didn't sound it loud, and I said, well, man, he can't do that, play around that truck like that. About that time, he drove up to the road, the entrance, and he said, come on, come on. And I cut the gas off and ran out there and jumped in the truck with him. And he said, what's wrong? He said, Henry Bowles' smokehouse on fire. And we went out there, and we didn't save the smokehouse and the washhouse, but we sprayed water on his house, and it was so hot that it would crack. I mean, the paint would crack. And we saved his house. And
and that's the house now that's was moved to
Heritage
Park.
That's right, that's the house they moved, yeah. Mm-hmm.
There was also a big fire in the 70s downtown on Main Street. Do you remember that fire?
No, I sure do.
Tell us about that.
We had worked some cattle that day, and we stopped at I guess George was running that beer joint then, and we stopped there after we got through working it. It was up and getting dark, and we was in there drinking beer, and fire alarm went off, and we went around there, and all that from up at Werner
Zimmerman
was in there, and that's where the fire started up in that area of the old Lapine store, and then. It came down into the hardware, and then it got into the Knables, and it got into the next door, which was, well, it was several things. Bossy's used to be there, and Becker had a beer joint in there. And then I owned the next building, and I had fertilizer and stuff stored in there. And but I had poured a concrete floor in it. And, you know, I had a forklift and a bunch of stuff in there. So we just ran down to the granary and got in my bobtail truck. And we loaded some of that stuff on it, and then loaded the forklift on it. And that's where the fire stopped, at that building. It didn't get into the one that, well, the steakhouse was in it, and now I think the mayor got a restaurant or something in there we went in there one time going to eat. And they said, you have to go upstairs. And I said, I'm not going to crawl those
steps. Well, and fire trucks came from all over.
Yeah, they came from Hutto and Round Rock. And I don't know if it, Austin fire truck came out or not, but it just demolished those buildings. And
nobody was hurt.
No, and the brick between Botts's old store and my building, the wall was about 21 inches thick. It was solid brick.
Firewall.
And I sold, what's that electrician? His wife died, and he belongs to church, but I don't think, lives up in, kind of northwest part of Old Town.
Well, that's okay, he bought it.
But anyway, I sold him brick for his home, and I think I sold enough brick to somebody else for their house. And and that's the only building, only piece of property I owned that didn't have any insurance on it. I asked W.E. one day, I said, I had that place insured, and he said, hell, I thought that thing would never burn down. He said, I just dropped it.
Back to volunteers.
A fellow the other night, and he wanted a phone number, and he said, well, she's an attorney. And she said, he said, what's her name? I said, her last name is Smith. And he said, what's her first name? I said, I know it, but I can't think of it. And he hung up, and I sat there a few minutes and watched TV, and I got up because she got an ad in a Pflugerville Flag, and I got up and started to walk over, and I said, Fayreen. That was her name. It just popped in my, but that.
Okay, on your volunteer service, you were also one of the organizers of the Lions Club back in 1975.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about.
No, 75.
75?
Yeah.
Yeah. Tell us a little bit about organizing the Lions Club.
Well, I really can't say that I organized it. When they organized, I joined, and I was a member for years, and I was president of that organization for 3 years. And I got a lot of donations for the club. In the back where they got their barbecue pit, I got all the steel and the concrete donated. And then they built a building. And then all the, I don't know what you call it, monument or whatever out in front, they were talking about one of those. And I went up for several days driving through the hill country trying to find some rock that was big enough to, you know, put it on. Couldn't find it. And one day I stopped in over here at Hutto, went in there and introduced myself, and he said, I can make that for you. And I said, how much would you charge us? He said, I won't charge you anything. And he built it and he erected it for us for nothing. And then when they added the storeroom, Skeen Steel, they furnished the steel And I got an old boy that I sold that seal place to. He furnished got a company to furnish the concrete. And he said, oh, on second thought, I'll just do the labor too. And so all I had to do is build two walls, one down the side and over to the building. And I don't know, I had several members, they got teed off because I got a lot of donations, you know, at our pickup raffle. I didn't get lots of donations, but some of them got, you know, donations for lunches and, you know, this little dilly. But I got donations for, you know, the High Lift company up there, they gave me a donation of a rental on one of their tractors for a day, and that runs into hundreds of dollars. And then it was a lot of things. A guy that sells tools up there, he gave me all kinds of two chainsaws and whatever, you know, mounted into money. And it was a few of them in the club, they thought, they one night they made a remark, said, well, how does Willard ever get all these donations? And one old boy popped up, he works for the big lumber company.
Calcasieu?
Yeah, no, over here.
Home Depot?
Huh? Home Depot. And but he works in Austin now. But he said, have you ever given it a thought that maybe Willard did something for them sometime? And they're just repaying him? So everything got real quiet. but I just, you know.
Well, the bottom line is the building has served a lot of community functions.
Oh, it sure has.
It was certainly a meeting place where people have a lot of memories that they could get together. And I think the same volunteer effort happened when Pfluger Hall was built, with the volunteer firemen doing a lot of the work themselves.
Oh, yeah.
They needed something. The community came together to try to make it happen.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, the Lions Club donated $12,000 to them.
For the Pfluger Hall?
Yeah. And then when they named it Pfluger Hall, it was one fella came in one night and he said, what they do that for? Said we donated $12,000 to that. And he just was raising his head. He thought it ought to be called Pflugerville Hall. And I looked at him and I told him, I said, I don't want to be smart or anything, but I said, you know, the Pfluger family raised $100,000 to get that thing started. Oh, I didn't know that. But see, don't say something unless you know. And drop that. Of course, I've been accused of charging them too much for the Lions Club land. Sold them 2.5 acres for $25,000 and with all utilities around it. And we paid $40,000 for the bank up there. Didn't have nothing. So it.
Little bitty old piece.
Yeah. It.
I'm going to go back to some of the business people that you remember. Miss Lively, Irene Lively.
Oh, yeah.
She was the main cook in town. Tell us a little bit about the Lively Cafe.
Oh, the Lively Cafe some of us commented when she opened up. because Irene was, she was kind of wild, and a bunch of us, we made the remark that she wouldn't last 6 months, but she was there 26 years, and I tell you, if we could get a restaurant like that into Pflugerville again, and a cook like she cooked, I guarantee it would hurt some of these other people. Because, she could make, well, anything. She, chicken fried steak or
just coconut pie.
Yeah, coconut, anything. Her enchilada. Camille had an aunt that's been all over the world, had lots of money. And she loved Mexican food. And we told her one time, she lived out at Buda, and we told her to come see us. We'll take you up there, and it's not a fancy restaurant, but I think you'll like it. And she came out, and we took her up there. She ate those enchiladas. She said, "Those are the best enchiladas I ever ate in my life." And she's been to foreign countries and everywhere. But she was a cook. I mean, I used to come in from hunting in Colorado or Wyoming, kill an elk and bring her steak. Man, I tell you, she could fix it. she was some good cook. And I remember Emma Remmert worked for her, and Irene Lively was postmistress that time, and she'd eat there all the time, and she'd always call over and see what was on the menu. And so she called over one day, and I don't know what else they had, but they had brown beans. And she said, "And cut the beans." When she came over there, all those brown beans were cut in half. Oh, I had a lot of Tom, Dick, a lot of foolery who went on. No fools, no fun. So you look back at all those old things
There was another character, Elsie Blackman. Tell us about Elsie Blackman.
Oh, Elsie? Oh, he was our constable, 80 years old. We didn't need no constable.
He'd walk the streets, and then he would take the mail down and hang it on that hook.
Yeah, well, the one that did carried the mail down, I guess Elsie did it for a while. I can't remember him doing it so much as old man Pearson. And old man Pearson, he would get up and meet the train at 12 o'clock at night and 4 o'clock in the morning. And I remember I had rabbits and guinea pigs, and had 1-inch chicken wire on the front of the cages. And I went out there one morning, and man, those cages were just torn open. And we couldn't figure out who it was. And we thought that it might be old man Pearson's dog. "Oh no, it's not my dog," said. "My dog is, when I go meet the train, he's here." And Dad put some poison out.
You better not tell that.
Well, it came on the place. And the dog was about 3 blocks down from the house the next that night. He didn't meet that train. But I used to raise guinea pigs and sold them to the state for, I don't know what they did with them, some kind of
research
deal. And I just
So Elsie never handcuffed anybody?
Not that I know of.
Okay.
Not that I know.
Did he get paid for his job?
I don't know if Elsie got paid or not, or if he was just a volunteer.
Okay.
And
now, another person was, Fish Kimple opened a movie place in Pflugerville once upon a time. Fish Kimple.
Moved a movie place?
They had movies right there below Mr. Nazy in that building between Nazy's and the bank. You don't remember
no,
that?
No, he opened a grocery store.
Okay.
I don't remember Fish opening the...
I don't know that it lasted very long, but yeah. I think that was after the grocery store that he had.
Yeah, well, if he did, I don't remember it.
Yeah.
Now, the one that H.H. Pflugger had the movie, he had the movie between where the restaurant is and the service station. And he had a electric plant out there that before Pflugerville got a lot of electricity. And he had a outdoor movie there.
Had so it was between Lively's Cafe and the service station?
Uh-huh. Yeah, he had a board fence up. And when we were kids, we went there all the time. And we thought we were...
Do you remember the name of any of them?
No.
No. What about Mr. Lapine?
Mr. Lapine?
Until it stops bombing.
What is that?
The clock.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Now you can ask about Mr. Lapine.
Okay. Mr. Lapine... tell us about what his store had to offer.
Well, he had a hardware store, and furniture, and he also had the funeral home. But his funeral home, he just was represented the funeral home, and he had an agreement with some funeral home out of Austin that would, you know, do all the work, but he was all the funerals went through him out here, you know, years ago, and but he had you know, hardware and some furniture and it's some plows, not a lot, but. But he had a, right there where the restaurant, well, the dog deal now, he had a shed there between he and Steger where he stored his implements. And then it was a building right where the restaurant is, it was I forget what that old man's name is. He was a shoe repair man. And Willie Weiss bought that building, and we moved it all the way out to where Willie Weiss lived. I don't know what he did with the building. I don't know if he made a house out of it or storage, but I remember.
Okay, Mr. Kimple had the lumber yard.
Yeah.
And you mentioned Herbert, Kermit.
You talking about Rip or the old man?
Well, let's talk about the old man first, if you remember.
Well, the old man, he was kind of retired, and he was at the lumber company all the time, but I don't think he might have ran it before Calcasieu came in. It wasn't Calcasieu, it was Mutual Lumber Company in Austin, and I don't know if they had a working agreement with Rip or not, but eventually Rip owned it. I mean, he owned it because I remember I bought the old lumber yard down at Copeland, and they said it had some of the most beautiful lumber in there you ever saw. And Rip said, man, I don't know what to do with that kind of lumber. It didn't have a knot in it or nothing. 1x12s and 2x4s and all that. And they were just, I mean, perfect. You don't get lumber like that anymore. And yeah. I don't know what he ever did with it.
When you ran around with Hub or Marvin, you mentioned Marvin earlier, what were some of the things y'all did for recreation or entertainment here in town?
We played marbles and we played, you know, pass football and played catch and that in baseball and just anything that was going on.
Did y'all ever go up on that CCC camp? Did they have any kind of entertainment there, or did y'all go on the property?
No, I went on the property some because I became friends with some of those fellows. I played golf with some of them, and we'd go down to Bastrop and play, and some of them became real good friends. And in fact, here a few years ago, my old platoon sergeant, when I went in the Army, died, and he was from Brenham. I went to the funeral, and I went out to see this one guy. And we were all friends. I mean, you know, we ran around together
From the camp, would they come into Pflugerville and shop or do things?
They'd come in and drink beer. But we'd go to dances and stuff like that.
And then they would, what would be their normal routine? Would they get up and then go out and work on the areas around to build the structures?
I guess. I didn't know too much about how they operated, but they would go out. And one place I can think of now, if you go down Bowles Lane and the land that, Kermit Heyman, I guess, is working. There's still some of those deals in there. That's the only ones I can place right now that are still there.
Do you remember any politicians coming to Pflugerville to talk?
Oh yeah, they used to come out and politic and have speeches and all of that. Grover Kimple used to have them down at his place and have a barbecue and everything. I better not say this because when but he'd charge them, you know, pass out around.
So who were some of the pot? Did Lyndon Johnson ever come out here, or Homer Thornberry?
Oh, back in those days, practically everybody would come.
They would always make a stop to try to get the votes.
Yeah, and you know, at one time, there was a whole bunch, Paul Blair, and I can't remember all the sheriff's name, detective. They'd come out and play poker with us, and it was wide open. I mean, they didn't.
It was Democrats against Democrats back then, right?
Yeah. It, you know, everybody was a Democrat back then, I guess.
What about, did they ever have, like, medicine shows or special?
They used to have medicine shows down there on where I had my humble agency. That was a vacant lot then, and Oh, they would come in quite frequently and have those medicine shows and all that medicine and cure all.
Do you remember going to those as a
Were
you a child then, a kid?
No, I was, you know, I guess, you know, 10, 15 years old. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they'd come in, and Dad and Uncle Fritz owned the property, and they would pay them so much to set up on it. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't much, but it, you know, it little. And no, and I bought that from him when I opened the gasoline business. So
what would your sisters do as far as entertainment or recreation, the girls?
Teach school, I guess. Oh. Edith played basketball, and I don't know what Mildred would do. And of course, Pearl and Ella, Nora and Ella, they were all older, and they were gone. I mean, you know, I remember when Pearl and I got married, I wasn't too old, but Nora, she went on to Temple and became a nurse, and Ella got married, and they moved to San Antonio. So
one of the things is your family has a history of living a long time. You have two sisters that lived to be, 104, and another one, 103?
Mm-hmm.
And
I don't know what Nora was. She was 96 or 7 or something like that. Mildred is 98 now. She just turned 98 in December, and I turned 94. So it was 7 in our family, including mother and dad, that reached the 90s or better. 2 of them over 100. And George lived till he was 78, but old goals got him. He smoked too long, and he finally quit, but it was too late. Mm-hmm. And Pearl, I don't know what happened to her. She just, you know, she got married and never had any kids, and of course IB was sick for years, and she took care of him and wouldn't put him in a home of no kind, and she just worked herself to death. And after he died, well, she had some nieces up there with her kids one Saturday. And after they got through eating, and she said, "I believe I'll go up to Nora and lay down a while and rest." And so they took her up there, and she laid down, and they put a phone by her. And they called up her, and she didn't answer, and they went up there, and she was dead.
Hmm. Yeah. Do you remember the first phones at your parents' house?
Yeah, the number was 44. Yeah, we'd ring that, and the central would answer, and you give them the number, and then if it was on a line out in the country where 3 or 4 people were on it, everybody listened to the conversation. If you wanted to get anything started, just...
Yeah, was that with the ward, or was that already with Southwestern Bell?
Oh,
well, the ward supposedly had a phone service.
The wards had it, and then Southwestern Bell, I guess, took it over, and Frances Whelan, she was operator for gosh, years and years and years.
Yeah. Well, is there anything else you want to tell us? When you look at the city of Pflugerville now, you can look back a long time. And there were some things that made a difference. It kind of rocked along, and then all of a sudden it changes. So what do you think were some of the big changes that happened?
Well, I'll tell them one thing. I rode my little Shetland pony down to get the mail in the morning tied to an iron post. I don't believe I'd ride him down now with the traffic. just the times. I mean, people say times are changing. I tell them they're not changing. They've already changed.
Well, your first home that you lived in, it became a subdivision.
Mm-hmm.
And now, where you and Camille are living, you're having houses all around you now. They're filling in.
Yeah, it. I enjoyed living up there. And I liked it too. I could crawl out of the window and go down the gutter and slip off at night when Mother and Dad thought I was. I'll say one thing that personally, and I've talked to a lot of other folks, I believe we've lived through the best times. With the way the world is going now, I don't know. It's too much. Electrical stuff, or punch a button and you can do this, and punch a button and you can do that, and I don't know. And two, today people don't pay no attention to you. When I was still up and walking and go to the mail and walk in to the post office and say good morning to somebody, they'd look at you like he's crazy. And people don't have time for anybody. They just go. And I don't know, I've always been one that liked to be friendly and visit and I don't know, just pay attention to somebody else. Not that it was all me, it was them too.
Well, I think that was early Pflugerville, everybody knew everybody.
Yeah, well, that's right.
And if there was a need for something, you helped your neighbor.
Yeah.
And if there was a need for the community, you worked together to try to.
Well, I remember one time, Pestle Fowler and who was it? We held a trustee election, and it wasn't enough of them to come in to vote, and so we just got sat down and we went up one street and down the other one, and we took an inventory of who was living in Pflugerville. We knew everybody that lived in every house in Pflugerville. And then, one time they had an election, and that's when Fish Kimple was running the grocery store down there. And we sitting up in front of tables, and he walked out, and it was a whole bunch of us there, and we said, let's all go in there and vote for old Fish for trustee. We went in there and voted, and we darn near got him elected. we used to have fun. I mean, after the war, somebody getting married, and we'd have a stag party, and drink beer and eat barbecue and shoot a little crap, play a little poker, and just had a good time. I mean, we didn't play for big money, just you know, pastime, really. But when they say now, some of them so opposed to gambling, well, you can't walk into a store you can't gamble. They got tickets.
All the tickets.
I buy the ticket, and if that's not gambling, I don't know what is. Yeah.
Tell a little bit about Pestle Fowler. He was the cotton buyer.
Yeah. Pestle Fowler, he was kind of a character. He bought Fowler. I don't know just how that worked with him, because he's a fella, Rhinelander, came over from Buta all the time, and then went on to Taylor. And I think they were kind of in cahoots, and I'm not sure, but I know Fowler at one time back in the 40s, he was buying cotton and hauling it to Houston. Had a bobtail truck, and old Trinity Collins, a colored fellow, would drive it at night. We'd load him late in the afternoon, and he'd come in, you know, 5-6 o'clock in the morning, and gas up and everything, and we'd go down and load the truck, and Max Kimple drove it, and that truck made 2 trips a day to Houston, and you could haul 13 bales, and if you put 14 on it, I guarantee you, you got a overweight ticket down at some little old town going down towards Houston.
Do you remember the slaughterhouse down here on
the creek? Oh, God. Do I remember it? I worked in there with old Ted Banner. I'd go down there and we'd butcher cattle, and especially on Friday afternoons, and then we'd go back, and Lester Timmerman was working for Albert Bowles at the time, and they made some of the best bologna sausage I ever ate. And they would fix it that afternoon, and when Ted and I'd come back in, well, man, we'd get us a bologna sausage and go in there and eat it. It sure was good.
So yeah. Did they buy their cattle locally, or did he raise his cattle or buy it from the people
he
here?
No, he bought it locally.
And then they slaughtered them there and then make their sausage in town, or did they make it out at the slaughter plant?
Oh, they made it in town.
Okay.
Now, we just came, brought the carcass in. And back then, when I first helped them, their refrigeration was just ice. We didn't have any electricity. And they had to put the light ice up above the meat. Of course, it was a...
And it would drip down on it?
No, it wouldn't. No,
or it would just keep it cool?
Yeah, just keep it cool.
And did they get the ice then from here in Pflugerville?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, old Walter Prince worked at the ice factory for years. I remember they had a shower between the ice factory and the oil mill office, and he was in there one day, and I poured, it was open at the top, and I poured a bucket of ice water over him. I didn't go around the ice factory for a good while. Oh, we were, you know, we used to be devils. I mean, we had a lot of fun. Well, we didn't have nothing else to do.
You had to look
for it. What about the bottling company? That was before your time, but did you...
That what?
The bottling company?
No, I remember that.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Ed Knabel had a... Right there were in Emil Bowles' pasture. That's where he had his first bottling plant. And then his next bottling plant was up there right below the fire hall.
By the railroad track?
Yeah.
Okay.
Old Bubba Stevenson lived in there a long time after Ed went to Austin with a 7-Up deal.
So did you drink some of it? You had to go to their store to buy it, or they sold it through the stores in town?
Oh, Ed would let us drink some down there. Yeah. And he was tight, but he'd jar loose a bottle every once in a while.
Did he make up his own formula then?
I don't know. But I do know that, let's see. When they were selling soda water for 80 cents a case, I had a fella that worked down there for him, said it cost him 2 cents a case to make.
Okay. So they put the caps on and everything.
Yeah, but...
Ed went on to Austin then and made a bigger business,
yeah,
didn't he?
Yeah, mm-hmm. And Henry Kimball went down there and worked for him for a long time and more or less ran the business. And then Ed died, and Henry kept on running it till he sold it. It has really grown, I'll tell you.
Well, another thing, Dessau Hall used to be a place a lot of people went. Did you ever go to Dessau Hall?
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. Went quite a few times. That tree grew up right in the middle of the dance floor. And people would dance around it. I went over. I was, you know, pretty young, but I went. Mutt Pfluger and Fonso Arndt and whoever lived in town. We'd go over.
What were some of the bands that would play there, or music that they would have?
Man, I don't remember. The only thing I remember, you know, when we were up in age, you know, growing up, and all of us was married, you know, Tuff and Linnell and Paul Jr. and his wife, and Kimple.
T-Boy, who'd you say?
Who? Kimple, Henry Kimple's daughter.
Daughter Marilyn?
Yeah. All of that group in there was some from Austin that came out. And that's when Doll Price would get these big bands. I mean, like Jan Garber and the two brothers had different bands.
Dorsey.
Huh?
Dorsey.
Do what?
Tommy and Jimmy Dorsey.
Yeah, Tommy and Jimmy Darcy and it was six or eight bands. What would happen, the way he could get them, they would have a dance in Austin or San Antonio, and they'd have an off night, and then they would play out there. And they always had a crowd. Now, Jan Garber, he was from New Orleans. Now, he really loved to play out there. He just became one of the
folks, I guess you'd call it. In fact, Jan Knabel, she was married. I mean, named after him.
Oh.
If you think about it, yeah, Linnell.
Did anybody end up in that little jail out there at Dessau Hall? They had a like a cage that was nearly that they would put people in.
In that jail?
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah, years ago they'd put them in there overnight. And
so did the police put them in, or
Price
or whoever?
Well, no, Cecil Robbins and there's some local guys that were deputies. And they'd lock them up, and then the sheriff's department would get them the next day. Yeah, they locked them up.
Yeah.
And they had one in Pflugerville. They had
jail?
They had one right there close to where the lumber yard used to be, where the blacksmith shop was.
Yes.
Just over against the lumber yard fence. And
they didn't leave them in there too many days since it.
No, they didn't leave them in there any just overnight or something like that. Mm-hmm. But they'd lock them up. I mean, it.
The light. One other thing about Charlie, 3 Point. Let's talk about Charlie's just a minute. Did you ever go in there?
Have I ever gone there? I think I owned part of the business as many times as we ate there. Gosh, yeah. In fact, old Frog brought me a cart of wood the other day.
Well, we thank you so much, Willard, for taking the time to tell your story. Nobody else has been around for more than 90 years to tell us what was going on. So that's Pflugerville, and you are a Pfluger, and we appreciate it.
Yeah, I guess I'm the last grandson of George Pfluger that's living.
That's right, because it's just you and Gladys and Mildred.
Yeah.
And probably the last of that generation too. There's probably no others in that generation.
That's right. That's over with.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah. You on here?